My name is Scott Baker. I've been a Georgist for 6 years. I'm now president of Common Ground New York City, which is a Georgist activist group. I've taken a dozen classes at the Henry George School, and now I'm a teacher. So today we're going to talk about the debt of the United States, which is real, but the solutions which most people don't know to solve it. Americans of all political beliefs have been taught that the debt that America is broke, that something must be cut and or taxes must be raised. While the debt is real, it pales in comparison to the solutions that we have to solve it. And in short, America is not broke. And I think at the end of the evening you'll see why America is not broke. I started taking classes at the Henry George School about 6 years ago. And that opened my eyes to what was really going on with the economy and how things are not the way they seem. Before that, it was like most people. I thought we were getting deeper and deeper into debt. There was little we could do except make hard choices between austerity and raising taxes. And then I discovered one big solution was the Georgist solution, which I will get into more detail. And as I went along, I discovered other solutions as well. And it was about that time, I guess around 2011 or 12, John Boehner said, he got up in the press conference and he said, "Face it, we're broke." And I don't know if it was that exactly, but something catalyzed me into thinking, you know, this is just wrong. The politicians shouldn't be saying this anymore. I know it's wrong. And I've got to do something about it and get the word out. So Zuccotti Park came along a little bit after that, Occupy in Zuccotti Park, the Occupy Wall Street movement. And what I did was I created a flyer, which was called America is Not Broke. So the flyer is actually the inspiration for the book. And the flyer made it into an article in Huffington Post, which I have a few extra copies of over there. And in the actual flyer, there's pictures and it's a lot more colorful and so forth. But I and some members of Common Ground New York City, which I'm president of, we handed them out by the hundreds. So we were in Zuccotti Park. I was in Zuccotti Park 5 times, and then I was in with different members and we handed these out. And so they went out by the hundreds, and that was great. And it inspired me to keep writing articles about it. And so I wrote articles and expanded on the themes that I knew were correct at that point. And I started putting these up on opednews.com, which is a top 100 blog. And it's one of the top progressive blogs on the net. So later on, I became a senior editor, now managing editor of Op-Ed News. We get about 250,000 to 800,000 uniques a month, unique views a month. And I've got about 200 articles up there. So, make a long story short, this publisher, Tayan Lane, came to me and they asked me if I would make a book out of some of my articles, basically an updated anthology. So I said, sure, that sounds like a good idea. So I downloaded about 30 of them and I cleaned them up, I updated them, I put some things in between to transition to the different articles, and this is the result. So, it's a big claim, $4 multi-trillion paths to a thriving America. So that's not what people think. People think we're in debt to multi-trillions of dollars and there's nothing we can do. Well, let's see if we can dispel that. So basically, I came up with four macro solutions. The first one, as people who come to the school might know, is sovereign money or debt-free money. The second one they'll definitely know if they come to the school, that's Georgism or land value taxation, sometimes called site reclamation or community land collection. I've heard this so many names because people don't like the word tax, so they try to rename it to a less threatening phrase. But it started out as land value taxation. There's tons of literature on it that way, so I kind of kept it that way throughout the slideshow and in the book. The third one, which you may not be as familiar with if you come to a school, is public banking. And that, if you do it state by state, if you have it in all 50 states or some of the bigger cities like New York, could really get the money back to where it's the most needed. And the fourth one I know most of you have never heard of, that's government financial asset hoarding. And the irony about that is that's probably the largest one. That may even be bigger than the other three put together. But we'll get to that at the end. And then I also cover a couple of smaller ones, and some people may disagree whether they're smaller or not. One is the local exchange currency system. This means basically having a like Berkshire bucks, or the example that I use in the book, buckaroos, which is from the University of Kansas City, University of Missouri, Kansas City. And that's something that is basically a local currency for a region. Now, I'm not going to cover that too much tonight because I don't have the time. And then the last one, of course, is regulation. Well, if you need a lot or a little, it's very much open to debate. But what we definitely need is one that prevents the criminogenic environment that ultimately costs society more. So if you talk to Bill Black, who was a super regulator during the S&L crisis in the early 1990s, he'd probably tell you that's a multi-trillion dollar solution right there. And I would agree with him technically, except that we never seem to get up to that level of regulation without either squashing the economy or having something pop out that was not anticipated. So anyway, I'm basically going to cover the first four of these. So I don't expect you to believe them right now, but try to keep an open mind and try to take the premise of the book, which is that people are plastic and they can change if they're given the right incentives. And by incentives, I mean economic incentives. So basically, we're going to talk about incentives and how to get people to behave in a certain way, even if they may not think of it and do it consciously, but because the incentives are there. And also, the book is based on the premise that people are open to reason and persuasion, and that they want something better, even if it's outside their comfort zone.
Okay, so this is basically what sovereign money is.
So all of these are or were sovereign money, which means that the government itself can produce it. It doesn't need a central bank. It can produce it, and I'll explain how it can do that a little bit later. But I just want to demonstrate that there have been actual sovereign money, which didn't come from borrowing, in other words, from the government issuing treasuries to a bank and the bank issuing back dollars. The government itself can issue dollars without going through that. And one of the interesting ways you can tell that is if you look at this pink or red seal on all of these bills, except the very first one, which was a continental, you'll see that comes up whenever it's United States money. In other words, when it's sovereign money, it's the front and back. So that's consistent. If you take out a Federal Reserve note, you'll see it has a green seal. So that's the way you can tell them apart pretty quickly. And of course, coins are always sovereign money because the mint produces those and the banks buy those as they need them. So there's the seigniorage, which is the cost to produce the money taken from the actual face value of the money. In other words, the face value is a dollar and maybe it costs 3 cents to coin a coin. So then it's 97 cents seigniorage to whoever produces that coin. So the seigniorage in this case always goes back to the government because this is all government money. Okay, so what is money? Is money a thing? It's been a lot of things in history. It's been cowrie shells, it's been beads, it's been metal tokens. Those are all commodity type money. So we can have that, but the problem with that is that you either run out of the commodity or somebody hoards the commodity or it becomes unevenly distributed in some way. So the availability of it, it usually gets restricted at some point. So kind of as society has evolved, we've gone past commodity money, and there really isn't any major currency today that's commodity-based. So all of the modern money today is fiat money. And what it is, all money is just really three things, and really it's only two things up here. A means of exchange and a store of value, however imperfect, meaning that the supply of money can change what it's worth. The third thing that it's not wealth. So for example, I went onto a site and I bought $100 trillion, and I only paid $7 for it. So that's a genuine bill, but it's out of the Bank of Zimbabwe. It's a legitimate central bank. But unfortunately for them, that's only worth $7 now. So we used to be on the gold standard too, but then during the Great Depression, we went off it internationally, and then we went off it domestically in 1971. So now we only have purely fiat money. And I'll get to everybody's fear at this point because they remember the 1970s, which is inflation. I'll get to that, I promise. But fiat money, the first thing to know is inconvertible. It's inconvertible money made legal tender by a government decree, which is what a fiat is. It's a government decree. And taxes are one of the main ways that government can make a particular form of money acceptable as legal tender. All right, so now we come to the first axiom, which you should kind of keep in the back of your mind as we're talking about monetary reform. Money should exist in sufficient quantity to meet the productive capacity of the nation. If it's too little, then we have deflation. If it's too much, we have inflation. Okay, what can fiat money do for the economy? Well, it can pay for infrastructure, it can pay for Social Security, it can pay for R&D, all of these things. It can pay for anything that the government decides that it should pay for, and hopefully the government represents us when it does that. But what I want to talk about a little more here is that if it is used in a way that has a positive money multiplier, you actually get back more than it is shelled out. Now that may sound a little bit hard to believe, but the way that works is, remember, every business is a profit-making institution. They're all in business to make money. So that if you pay a dollar for a notebook, let's say, it may only cost that vendor 80 cents or 90 cents, because it's a low-margin business, to produce that notebook. So he's making 10 cents, let's say, on that notebook. So there's a profit there, and that profit is going to be spread throughout the community. You multiply that up by millions, and it becomes a lot of money. So that's how the money multiplier works. And plus the fact that, you know, as you establish a good and a service into the economy, if you have a store, you may have unanticipated needs that, in other words, customers come in and they may want something, and then you say, hey, I can fulfill your need, and there's a new market. So you may grow that way, but of course if the store's not there, it can't grow in the first place. So the money can multiply that way too. Now one of the other way it works is if you have a negative money multiplier. And so if you contrast that to the positive, a negative multiplier would be like a tax cut for the rich, because the rich will put their money into asset classes like stocks and bonds, into land, which we'll talk about more later, and it'll kind of just sit there. And while it may appreciate, it's not because the stock itself has some contributory value into the economy. The stock is just like a marker. It's a price point. The company under the stock has value, certainly. And when the company becomes an IPO, then they get some money, and that's value for them. But they don't get money after that, unless they do a secondary offering. So these kind of investments are not really going to multiply the money. They're just storage vehicles and ways for the rich to collect rent, essentially, which we'll talk about a little bit. And military spending is another example of a negative money multiplier. Now these two studies that I referred to, they're in the book. One is from the AARP that says for every dollar you spend on Social Security, you get $2. And the other one is from the Southern Community Resource Center, I believe. That says for every dollar you get $1.80 in Social Security. Now the second one, the AARP one, to contrast that to the military, and they say that if you spend a dollar in the military, you get 70 cents back. Now why is that? Because, well, the military builds something and it basically just sits there, unless it has to get used in a war. And if it does get used in a war, then it blows up and you can't use it again. So it's either going to sit there and rust or get obsolete or need a lot of guarding or something like that. So it doesn't really generate additional income for the economy. Or it's going to get blown up, in which case it may actually be destructive and it may take money out of an economy. Okay, now I'm not saying we don't need the military, but it's not economically generative, that's what I'm saying. So now the question you have to ask yourself before we get any further into sovereign money is, what have the trillions spent on the banks actually done for the economy? Now, according to Professor L. Randall Ray, who did a study with two PhD students of his, the Fed has spent $29 trillion as of 2013, so it's more now. But that's including rollover loans to bail out the banks, and not only the banks here, but banks in Europe as well. So this sounds like an incredible amount, but he's counting all the rolled over loans, which have yet to be paid back and probably never will be.
Over what time period?
That's since the crisis, 2008 through 2000, like the middle of 2013 when he finished the study.
It's a big number for that.
It's a big number, yeah. And again, it's not just American banks, but European banks too. Because he's going by what the Fed purchased, whether it's mortgage securities or CDOs or whatever they, you know, he rolled it all up. Everything together, and then all the rotating loans. Okay, so that is that. Now, here's everybody's biggest fear, so I put it in red. So what about inflation? That's what people worry about. The first time I say sovereign money, that's the thing most people worry about the most. So remember the first axiom. Money should exist in sufficient quantity to meet the productive capacity of the nation. So there shouldn't be too little and there shouldn't be too much. If there's too much, we're going to get inflation. But there are ways to measure this which are pretty well established, and which, you know, I'm not going to advocate for one or the other here, but I want to just demonstrate one. There's something called the output gap, and that comes from the nonpartisan Congressional Budget Office. Now, the CBO says that in the crisis, our actual GDP, which is this blue line, went down below the red line to over $1 trillion. In other words, we could have potentially had this red line of GDP, but instead, because the economy went off the rails, we stopped producing, and we came down to here, which is what, like 14.5 trillion, and we could have been up here at 15.5 trillion. So in the nadir of that, we were over $1 trillion short of our potential. And we're still, at least as of the middle of 2013, we're still short and we're still kind of creeping up. But you notice too, this red line is starting to bend down. So this is a bad sign. This means that the economy is starting to factor these lack of production in, and it's becoming a sort of semi-permanent state. So we're losing our capacity because people grow old, their skills become obsolete, the resources aren't there because they haven't been used in a while. So we don't want the red line to go down, we want the blue line to catch up and hopefully to elevate the red line and make it grow faster. So when we're talking about how much money to produce, well, the banks, the private banks, which produce almost all the money in the economy, are not producing enough. So really what we want is the government, at least I think as a sovereign money advocate, what we want is the government to come in and make up the difference. So according to the CBO, we could be spending $1 trillion more without producing inflation. That doesn't mean we can just give everybody $1 trillion, but if we spend it on something like infrastructure, which we know we need, and which the American Civil Engineer Society has said we need about $2 to $4 trillion in 5 years. If we spend it on something like that, we know that it'll absorb that kind of money, and we won't have inflation. And in fact, it'll trickle out. The question then is, why are we renting our money from the Federal Reserve Bank, I'm talking about the government now, when government could create it itself? And since the Federal Reserve Act of 1913, with minor alterations, the federal government has paid the bank for money with interest-bearing treasury bonds whose rate is largely determined by that bank. So they raise the rates when they think the economy is getting too hot. We have to pay the interest to basically get money out of them, and then it becomes more expensive for us to essentially rent our own money. Well, we don't have to do that at all. We actually have something in the Constitution called the Coinage Clause. That's Article 1, Section 8, Clause 5, and that gives Congress the authority to coin money. And you'll notice that money is in capitals and coin is in lowercase. And an interesting thing about the Constitution, if you read a good reproduction, you'll see that coin, whenever they talk about coin as in to make, as in to coin as a verb, the coin is always lowercase. When they talk about a physical coin as a noun, like gold and silver coin, then it's in uppercase. And they're consistent about this. So they meant to make, not coin money, which would be an awkward phrase. There's a paper by Robert Nadelson, who came out of Harvard, and I think he's in the University of Missouri now, and he talks about this some more, and I reference him in the book as well. He has a long paper about this, how it has to be to coin as a verb, not coin as noun, so I hope that puts that to rest. But in any case, we actually had debt-free money in circulation called United States notes, which you can see pictured there. And we had them for the longest time of any kind of money. We had them from 1862 to 1996. And you can still buy them on eBay, which as a matter of fact, I did, which is where that one comes from. Because I bought two $5 notes on eBay. I was gonna take the one out in my wallet, but that's just as good. But they go for twice face value in Federal Reserve notes. In other words, you pay $10 on eBay and which would be considered a Federal Reserve transaction, Federal Reserve note transaction, and you get one $5 U.S. note. So instead of it being inflated, it's actually in deflation. There's so few of these United States notes that you have to pay twice the Federal Reserve note in order to get one. So much for the argument that government always overproduces money and it leads to inflation. In fact, in this case, they underproduced. We had $450 million of these, $450 million, $451 million during the Civil War, which turned out to be about 40% of the federal budget at that time. Then it went down to $300 million about 20 years later, and it stayed there because we went into a depression, which is basically a form of deflation because the money got pulled out when it went to $300 million. So the Congress said, no more, we're not going to take them out, even though the banks want us to. And they kind of left it there. So it became a $300 million stub, basically, an extra pot of money. And you know, then the Federal Reserve eventually came in 1913, and they started making money, and it kind of supplanted the U.S. note. But it was there all the way through 1996 when Treasury finally burned its stock and said, we're not going to make any more, because they say it's equivalent to Federal Reserve notes, but it's not. And I know somebody who filed a lawsuit to prove that. All right, now talking about filing lawsuits in the Supreme Court, which my friend did, the Supreme Court ruled in Juilliard versus Greenman in 1884 in an 8-1 decision that the government may make paper money on the, under the Constitution. This was the last of a series of legal tender cases that established the government's right under the Coinage Clause to make paper money. And we can, of course, today we make any kind of money electronically that we can make physically. All right. So now, as far as the debt goes, this is the whole thing in the book now. Why? Maybe it's not even important, so we don't have to worry about it. Well, some schools of thought actually say that. There's a school of thought out there called modern monetary theory, which says basically that the Federal Reserve is part of the government, and therefore it's money we owe ourselves. If we owe it to the Federal Reserve, we owe it to ourselves, so don't worry about it because it's just an accounting trick. But consider this. The Federal Reserve Bank only owns 18% of the Treasury bonds. And by the way, I should point out the Treasury bonds is technically a 30-year Treasury issuance. A Treasury bill is a 1-2 year issuance, and a Treasury note is anything in between that. But I'll say Treasury bonds for now, or I may just say Treasuries. Most people just say Treasuries because it doesn't really make a difference. But anyway, the Federal Reserve owns about 18% of these bonds. The rest are owned by other entities. So that means governments like China, which is our second largest foreign holder after Japan, can buy our bonds, and they can appreciate our currency because they're pulling money out of our currency while they're taking, you know, in other words, they're taking our dollars and they're giving their yuan. So they have to produce more yuan, which inflates their currency, which depreciates their currency and makes ours more valuable. Now, that sounds like a good thing on the surface, but it's not, because it makes our exports more expensive. So one of the reasons that people say China is playing currency manipulation is because they're doing this. They're buying so much treasuries that basically it's making our dollar too strong, and our goods are so expensive that we can't sell them back to China, and it makes theirs so cheap that they can sell them all over the world, because the dollar still is a global currency. So this is one of the problems with that theory, that we don't have to worry about the debt and how we finance our economy. If we had truly sovereign money, we wouldn't need treasuries at all. And even the modern monetary theorists agree with this. I've been in touch with the two founders, and they admit it's an anachronism since 1971, and we went off the gold standard. All right, but in any case, another thing is that a whole class of very wealthy rentiers makes a big living off the interest of these bonds. And this is money the government could issue itself. So why should we pay these rentiers interest when the government could issue its own money and not have to pay any interest? Also, we don't always know that the bank will act in the best interest of the economy. They certainly didn't in the Great Depression. So they might decide to raise interest rates when we go into a depression or a recession. Well, they certainly do get that wrong. Usually they get that wrong. They start raising rates and then we go into a recession. So That's one problem. If we had government money, if we had truly sovereign money, we'd have an alternative to that. The government could keep spending money. It could create things through its programs, and we wouldn't have to worry about the Fed messing things up. And another thing, even in the good times, if you have to borrow everything, if the government has to borrow on a long-term project, it can add up to 50% to the cost of a long-term project, like a highway or a bridge or something. So if we didn't have to do that, we would save 50% on those projects, which is, of course, huge. All right, now here's where people start to worry about government corruption. They're going to go willy-nilly. They're going to print all these dollars and stuff. Well, first of all, I talked about the CDO and the way that we can restrict that by hard and fast rules. Other people have suggested a monetary authority. That's what the American Monetary Institute and Positive Money in the UK suggest. But in any case, the question you have to ask yourself is there more corruption now because the government has to borrow its money and has to depend on corporate interests, or would there be more corruption if it could issue its own money? And I'm not saying I know the answer, but that's something to think about. So certainly, you know, as Thomas Edison said, if the government can issue a dollar bond, it can create a dollar bill. So the question to you is, who do you trust more, the government or, I mean, the banks or the government? And of course, we could have both as well. We can have banks do for the private sector and the government for the public sector or some combination. And this is the Georgist section, which is what the school is all about, Henry George School. And at the bottom left there, you can see our illustrious founder and, well, not the founder of the school, but of the movement, Henry George. And you'll see on top of that the most succinct description of Georgism you're likely to see anywhere. So basically, Henry George was a 19th century political economist who wrote a bestseller called Progress and Poverty, in which he identified monopoly in land as the cause of unjust inequality. It is particularly evident in dense urban areas like New York. And his philosophy is called Georgism, or land value taxation, or the single tax, or community rent collection, and so forth. But basically, it's called Georgism. Now, notice I said unjust inequality. He's never said that everybody is equal and everybody should get the same rewards for their work. He recognized common sense that people have different skills and abilities and aptitudes, and so you know you're going to have unequal earnings. But what he was against was monopoly in land and rent seeking from that monopoly. So we're going to talk about that a little bit now. So all of these things are actually land. Now when people say land, they think of physical terra firma, but actually under the classical economic definition, all of these natural resources are land. So the difference is between land and capital, and in neoclassical economics, land and capital have been merged, so we have to disaggregate that. The difference is that land is created by nature. It's finite. It typically appreciates in value because the population grows and the population pressure demands more of it, so people want more of a scarce resource. And capital, on the other hand, is something that people make. It could be a machine, it could be this building. It's infinite within the capacity of land to produce more capital and the capacity of labor to turn that land into something useful. In other words, what capital is. So we're not going to talk about any of these ones in yellow tonight, even though it seems like there should be and they should be talked about. But mainly location, because location, as it turns out, is really a big deal. And that turns out to be a great amount of money. And so that, in addition to the multi-trillion dollar solution, the monetary part, this is another multi-trillion dollar solution. So you might wonder, well, is location really that important? But try to imagine this new building that just went up on 57th Street, which is now designated Billionaire's Row because of the expense of the condos, and where they can go up to $100 million. One did sell for $100 million in that building. And if you relocated that building, instead of being in midtown Manhattan, it was in midstate New York. See, I try to put it there. How much would it be worth then? And then you get some idea of the value of location. So you can have this great building in the middle of nowhere, and you know it's useless. So that's why location is so important. Now, New York City is actually the most densely productive place in the country, and it has a GDP of over $1 billion per square mile. So this is a great place to be, and lots of people make a lot of money. So one of the reasons for taking back the rent from the land is that if we only do a money solution, what's going to happen is the rentier is going to create a surplus. I mean, the society is going to create a surplus, and the rentier is going to take that surplus as rent. So at some point or other, you know, let's say you build a bridge and use government money. It's sovereign money, so great, we have this new bridge. Everybody can use it. Well, everybody living around the bridge has now got a benefit. So that their property value is going to go up, which means if you're renting, your rent is probably going to go up, and the person taking the rentier, is going to collect money for an unjust benefit, basically, improvement. So we say, as Georgists, well, you know, that's not fair. That landlord, that landowner, didn't create that bridge. They just happened to be in the right place at the right time. So we need to take that surplus back. So that's the reason, basically, for taking back the surplus of the location. So this is a chart of what happens to a typical house. You can see that the house gets smaller over time and the land gets bigger because the land appreciates, while the capital, which is the house, gets depreciated because it wears out, it gets old, it gets holes in the roof or whatever. So it goes down in value, and this is about the rate it goes down. Houses typically depreciate 0.015 a year, and land appreciates 0.04% a year. And you know, the property tax that we have right now is actually two taxes. So we tax both the house and the land, so it's a little bit confusing. We should be really just taxing the land, because the land is the part that is not deserved, because you're just sitting there and you just happen to benefit from the location, whereas the house, well, we want people to make houses, we want people to maintain them, we want people to build buildings like this, so why tax that when penalize that activity? We want those improvements. So we shouldn't be taxing that at all. We should be untaxing the buildings, and we should be taxing the land to encourage efficient use of land and discourage hoarding. Okay. So now we get into what taxation ought to be. Now, as I said before, you know, some people don't like the word land value tax because it's got tax in it. So you can consider it a fee, or we can change our definition of taxation so that it's really less, less ornery, and people don't have such an objection to it. If we make it more friendly and we make it more of what it ought to be, then maybe people will look on it more favorably. So ideally, according to Adam Smith, who first developed the canons of taxation, taxes should be light on production. In other words, they shouldn't discourage production. That's what I was talking about with the land value tax. It should be easy and cheap to collect. Well, it's pretty easy to assess a land plot because you know what it is, and real estate brokers have been doing it for ages. It should be certain. In other words, the rich don't pay less than the poor, and you don't get loopholes and all kinds of ways to get out of your taxes. And it should be fair. It's based on what you receive. So there's a principle called benefits received, which basically says the charge should be proportional to the particular advantages the individual or corporation has received from the activities of the community or from the earth itself. That's the land. So this is truly fair. It's the payment for valuable services or for advantages that have already been enjoyed. Okay, so just to clarify this again a little more. So we have the two traditional types of taxation on the top. The left wing, a liberal type, is less to the individual, more to society, but it makes no difference between rent, wages, or interest. And on the right, on the bottom, on the second one here, over here, the people on the right say you should leave more to the individual and less to society, but they too don't make any distinction between rent, wages, or interest. But the Georgist proposal does something different. It takes the rent off the top, which actually is about a third of all of the income, and it leaves the wages to the labor, which made the money, and it leaves interest to the capitalists because that's what they've earned from their capital use. So it actually should satisfy the left wing and the right wing because it allows for society and it also allows for the individual to keep what they've made. I talk about this some more in the book as well. So what do we have now? We don't have that at all. We have actually an anti-Georgist system. And here I'm going to get a little more into actual New York City because it's good to illustrate with the environment that we know. So we have an anti-Georgist system. I talked about this a little bit, this 157, this building that's on 57th Street. And this is an actual example from the New York Post, this picture on the top left. Is a story that they ran where they compared the $100 million condo up here, and they compared it to a typical $1 million condo, and they found that the tax on that $100 million condo was only $17,268 a year, and the tax on the $1 million condo was actually more, $24,279. So it's not just that it's more, it's actually more than 100 times more. You know, in other words, the $100 million condo is paying less than 1/100th of the tax rate of the $1 million condo. So this is unbelievably unfair. This is because they've got a special deal in Albany. They got a 95% tax abatement, supposedly to create affordable housing, or bribing the developer to create some affordable housing. But the fact is the city loses $1.1 billion a year on this. And furthermore, they don't create that much affordable housing. And not only that, but it's not that affordable. So it's kind of a lose-lose-lose situation. So, you know, if you, I'm going to return to that in a minute, but you can see right away that's completely unjust. Another thing on the low end, that's on the high end, but on the low end you have another injustice. This was taken at night, so I apologize for being so dark, but this is a parking lot here, and then behind it is this big building, this 22-story building. Now that building is next to this, actually eight lots, but if you combine them, they're one parking lot. It's actually the building is paying 10 times the property tax of the parking lot. So you've got a parking lot which is so undertaxed, there's basically no incentive to build there. So the owner of that, which is called S&M Enterprises, I'll let you figure that out. It's an appropriate name, right? They actually can hold this parking lot vacant because there's no penalty not to. So they're waiting until they get some price that they think is the right price, and then they'll sell the parking lot and make millions, and you know, they'll cash out. But meanwhile, the city is losing an enormous amount of revenue. And this is not unique. Believe me, I've gone all over the city and I've documented this, and we've got a database in Common Ground, and this happens a lot, and it also happens to be 10-to-1 a lot. That seems to be a magic ratio for some reason between parking lots and buildings. So this goes on a lot, and it's costing us billions in the city. And another thing that happens is vacant lots are actually just paying a tiny, tiny amount of rent a year, like $300, like this one in the Bronx, 301 East 139th Street. And that's a perfectly good lot. You could put a building up there. I mean, yeah, it makes a nice little park at the moment, but it's not, you know, people are not really using it as a park, and it's basically some developer holding that land, paying $300 a year, and waiting until there's a boom in real estate, and then he's going to sell it and make $2 million or something. So, you know, the city is just completely losing on that. And in the meantime, you know, we've got 60,000 people now that are homeless, and it keeps climbing. It's more than doubled in the last 10 years. Now, according to a study from Picture to Homeless in Hunter College, there are actually three times as many apartments as needed to shelter everybody in every homeless person who goes to a shelter right now. In other words, all those people in the shelter, we could put them in homes. Some of them might need to be fixed up, but they're there. And we could do it three times over. So instead, we're paying these overnight rates at these hotels, you know, single-room occupancy hotels. We may pay $3,000-$4,000 a month. We're paying far, far in excess, and yet we have all of this vacant land and vacant apartments, and it's a crime. I mean, and Henry George recognized this, you know, in 1879 when he wrote Progress and Poverty, and it really hasn't changed. Just the amounts have changed. So what would we lose if we had land value taxation? All right, well, here's today's quiz. So suppose you're that billionaire looking for a $100 million penthouse. You have billions of dollars, that's no object for you. So how high would you go if the property tax was $1.73 million a year instead of just $17,268 a year? In other words, the property was taxed at about the same rate as that $1 million condo. So would you pay the same $100 million? Would you pay $75 million, $50 million, or less than any of the above? Anybody care to guess? Oh, okay. Well, I guess you can kind of figure out it would be less because you're paying more in the property tax, right? So if you're paying more on one side, you're not going to pay more on the other side. You can't pay more for both. So even if you're a billionaire, you know the value of money. So if you're paying almost $2 million a year in property tax, you're going to say, wait a minute, I don't want to pay $100 million for that condo as well. So the price of the condo has to come down, and that's how we take back the money that now goes to private developers. We raise the tax, the price comes down, people can afford to buy. In the meantime, they're paying what rightfully is locational value back to the city. The city collects the money, as it should, for that location, and we have a much better income stream. So it looks much more attractive if it's a $17,000 condo. So how much money are we talking about here? All right, well, this is Mason Gaffney, who's probably our best-known Georgist. He's been doing Georgism for 60-plus years. He's 91 now, or something like that. And he says that there's $5.3 trillion of rent in the United States. And he did that by adding up to 60% of the land, which is privately owned. In other words, of all the acreage in the United States, 60% of it is in private hands. And figuring out the rent, and he says it's $5.3 trillion potential rent. And Nicholas Tiedemann, who's a colleague of his and another professor, says that the rent readily available through taxation is already $1.5 trillion, because some of that $5.3 trillion is not being taxed at all right now. But we're only collecting $175 billion. So he says that if you collected the full $1.5 trillion, that the average annual income of the average American family would go up $6,300 if the single tax was adopted. And of course, he's also talking about untaxing the wages and untaxing capital at the same time. So even though you untax all these other things, you still get a big raise for the average American family, just because the single tax takes all that rent in. And because you untax the other things, they get an increase. All right, so with the land value tax, we could also eliminate deadweight taxes on wages, sales, fixed capital, that's what I was just saying. The major cause of boom and bust cycles, which is land speculation, and probably you remember the subprime mortgage meltdown that led to the crisis. That's what started the whole thing. And we'll see a little more when we get to the banks how that starts to get into land. And most rent-seeking activity would go away if we had land value taxation. I believe that the cause of most political and other corruption would go away. A lot of people believe that, actually. Unjust inequality, we talked about that, based on monopoly of resources, and not just land, but oil and gas and water and pollution and all of these other things and all those other resources, solar energy that we saw in the first part of this section. We would get rid of urban sprawl. Land would get used more efficiently. We would get rid of blighted warehouse neighborhoods. We would get rid of the enormous tax breaks like I told you about for 157. And then developers would be incentivized to build to sell at more reasonable prices. And by the way, you know, that 157, people don't even live there. They buy these, the Russian oligarchs or Chinese oligarchs. They want to keep their money somewhere safe. They buy here. They don't stay here. They don't spend here. It just becomes warehouse property also. So they don't actually contribute that much. They're here maybe a few weeks of the year, and then they just leave it as an appreciating asset. All right. So under the current assessments, we could replace all the taxes on wages, sales, buildings, commercial property, hotels, etc., with an 18% tax on land value alone. Now, a lot of people panic when they hear 18%, but remember that the assessments are too low. The land is currently underassessed. So don't panic about that.
18% of what?
Oh, of the rent, full rental value. Sorry, I should have said that. So in other words, if you wanted to rent a lot, and it was $100,000 a year, and you charge 18% of that rental value every year, we wouldn't be able to untax everything else. The taxes now are typically in the, I guess it depends on the class, and we've got four classes, but they're like 2 to 4.5%, depending on whether it's commercial or private or condo or single family house or utility, which is a third class. So we're not anywhere near 18%, but then again, everything is under assessed, so if we had proper assessments, it wouldn't be 18% either. It would be some lower percentage on a higher assessed value. But that goes into where, you know, people are getting a lot of constituencies together, and they've been trying to force the taxes down, and they don't want to be taxed on their only asset. But under a Georgist system, you would have other options to make money. You would have no taxes on your wages. You would have no taxes on your capital. So you would have all of these productive options, and you wouldn't need to be, you know, paying a tax on the building. You would have to pay more on the land, but then you wouldn't pay all these other things. So people who are really using the land efficiently would be, you know, benefiting, and people who are hoarding land would be penalized, and people who are working would be benefiting also. So really, the people who deserve it would get the money. Okay. So a shift toward LVT would increase the cost of holding land, as I just said. It would stimulate new construction. It would create new jobs and new housing. There would be less penalty on buildings, new and renovated, sales and commerce, and wages. Now, New York City currently raises $7 billion a year in wage taxes, or about $1,000 per resident, which makes it more expensive to hire workers here. If we got rid of that, then we wouldn't be losing so many jobs to other states, and we would be able to attract more work here. So that's another advantage. Now, it actually has been tried here. That's why we have so many pre-war buildings, because during the Governor Al Smith's period from 1920 to 1931, the cost of the buildings were not taxed, and we were only taxing land because people actually knew what Georgism was. And so we actually had Georgism for a while, and so we had lower cost apartments, and we had a boom in building. And even though, yes, it was the boom years of the 1920s and so on, but even on top of that, New York grew disproportionately compared to the rest of the country, and it continued to grow even in the Great Depression, even when this law was phased out until the backlog was used up. So that's why we have so many pre-war buildings to this day. We had this this policy. Okay, so that's the Georgia solution. Okay, so now we get to public banking. There's currently one state public bank, and that's in North Dakota. There's also an Indian Nations with Chippewa Nation, which is in Oklahoma. That's why you've got these green stripes down here. So you got North Dakota, which has a state bank, and then there's a Chippewa public bank down there. And the reason for the public banks, and I should say, by the way, the TPP basically passed tonight, Trans-Pacific Partnership Bill. And according to the Public Banking Institute, this is possibly going to make public banks illegal worldwide, or at least for the people who signed it, all the countries, which is about a third of the countries. Because the premise of the TPP, or one of the premises, is that you shouldn't compete against commercial interests in an unfair way. And they could very easily say that a public bank is a government-supported institution, and it's unfair competition. So the Public Banking Institute, which is another outfit that I volunteer for, they say this might endanger public banks. And why that's important is what we're going to get into now. All right, we talked about banks a little bit before, but one of the things to keep in mind as we talked about monetary reform is that banks literally create money. They don't just make a profit, they actually physically make money. And as the Bank of England said, banks do not act as simply intermediaries, lending out deposits that savers place with them, nor do they multiply up central bank money to create new loans and deposits. Commercial banks create money in the form of bank deposits by making new loans. So that's contrary to what most people think, but actually that's how it works. And yes, they use collateral, and they don't. I'm not saying that they decide to wake up one morning and they say, "Let's make $1 million out of nothing." But as we've seen, they can overvalue the collateral. They can even do some corrupt things, like they can fire honest assessors. Bill Black says that 4,000 assessors signed a petition in the 2000s, in the early 2000s, and repeatedly to the regulators, and saying that, you know, we've been blackballed and we've been trying to make honest assessments, the banks wouldn't let us do it, and instead they hired assessors who would make higher assessments to overvalue the property so that they can make a higher loan. Now, why would the banks do this? Because obviously a higher loan is harder to repay, and if the borrower can't afford to pay it, or if they can't sell it at the price that they bought it, they're going to default. Well, the thing is, they're securitizing those loans, remember. They're selling them off as packages to other institutions. So as long as they do that, they're not on the hook. At least I thought they weren't on the hook. It gets a little nebulous when we actually have a failure, but you know, they wanted to offload those responsibilities to outside investors. But a public bank like the Bank of North Dakota doesn't do that. They don't securitize their loans. They keep them on their own books, or they partner with the smaller community banks. I'm going to talk about that in a minute, so that they don't, you know, they have skin in the game. All right, so this is how it works. So in the current system, you've got your taxpayer. He pays in state revenue. That's a plus. The state makes expenses or spends money. That's a minus. That's the state government. So the state government has money in the meantime before it spends it, and it invests it in a bank. And the bank is typically a commercial bank on Wall Street or one of the big banks. And that bank, in turn, invests, I use the term loosely, in the stock market and currency speculation, derivatives, and a variety of things. And they hope to make profits, which go back to the bank. And then they pay a very modest return in interest back to the state government. And it is modest because interest rates are so low now. It might be next to nothing. So the government doesn't make a whole lot of money that way. And they hope that this bank doesn't make a stupid decision and do something like, you know, go into the London Whale investment or some manipulation and doesn't lose money so that they can actually get their money back when they need it. So that's the current system. Now, a state bank system is a little different. You still have a taxpayer paying revenues and the state paying expenses, but they invest in a state bank, which in the case of North Dakota is what's called a DBO, a DBA rather, which means doing business as. So it's a doing business as. It's as if the state itself is the bank. Everything that's in the bank belongs to the state. Then the state bank may partner with the community banks, and the North Dakota has the highest per capita ratio of community banks in the country. So there's a lot of community banks in North Dakota to choose from. And then the community banks invest in all the things in the community, the factories and homes, and make mortgages and, you know, start up new businesses. And then those state projects, and also the state bank, it may itself actually directly invest in there as well. But anyway, those projects, hopefully they stay in the community, they make a little bit of money, then the profits go back to the state. You know, that's a little misleading. Some of it actually goes back to the banks that lent the money, of course. But since they pay taxes, these businesses, those taxes go back to the state directly. So you're keeping everything within the state. And it could be a city, too. If it's New York City, you could just substitute the word city for state, and then it's the same principle. So again, North Dakota has the highest per capita community bank ratio. They have the lowest foreclosure rate in the nation. They have the second lowest unemployment rate. It used to be the lowest, but now it's the second because the oil prices are low again and people are getting laid off. Still, it's the second lowest. It's about 3%. So this is something that they've had now since 1919. They've had this state bank. And during the crisis, in fact, over the last 20 years, there hasn't been a bank failure at all in North Dakota, whereas since the year 2000, so 15 years, there's been 500 bank failures nationwide. So we got 500 bank failures in every other state, but none in North Dakota, so that should tell you something. So we're down to 6,000 banks in total, used to be 8,000. And, you know, the community banks are still there in North Dakota. They're strong, they're making loans and helping the community. By the way, this chart comes from the study of innovation, from study of innovation report on state bank possibilities in Washington State. It's all in my book too. So why are community banks so important? Well, this is what happens with a small bank. You know, the small bank will make loans to the community. So their average loan to asset ratio, in other words, what percentage of their assets do they make as loans, or do they put out as loans, rather, is pretty high for all the small banks. It can be as high as 75% in North Dakota. It's pretty high in Montana and South Dakota. They also have a lot of small banks, but North Dakota's on top. Wyoming is a little lower. But then if you get to what we call SIFIs, the systemically important financial institutions like J.P. Morgan, it's way down here at 31%. That's according to Value Line. What do they do with the other 69%? Well, we saw they make derivatives investments, they buy stocks and so forth. So they're not doing a lot of loans. And so that's a problem, because all these small businesses and individuals can't get money, and they have to go to expensive options like credit cards and things that don't work so well. So, all right, and what's the share of loans made to small businesses? Well, for the giant banks, that's not that big. They only make 23% of the loans. The large banks make 17%, but the small banks make 33% of the loans. But the problem is the small banks only have 8% of the assets. So you see the giant banks have most of the assets, almost two-thirds. I think it is two-thirds now, actually. And the small banks only have about one-third of the assets. So another axiom here is that small and close services are better for communities than large and distant services. So that's the third axiom. And so if we have community banks, they serve the community better than a large bank. And here's another example of that. During the crisis, all of the, not all, but a lot of the bad loans were from the giant banks. These are the ones that defaulted. And also during the sub-crisis, I guess you could call it, 2001 to 2002, again, the giant banks had problems and the small banks kind of sailed through it and the credit unions were even better. So if we didn't have these giant banks making these bad loans, we might not have had a crisis. Because remember, they have most of the assets, they made most of the bad loans. So you multiply those two together and you've got a pretty bad situation. So they actually made 3% bad loans and the small banks a little over 1%. So three times as much for the giant banks. So this is a problem. So the counties, according to the Institute for Local Self-Reliance, the counties in which community banks account for a higher than average share of the market have endured significantly fewer home foreclosures. So again, that's what I was saying before. They have lower foreclosure rates. So the state with the most community banks, remember, was North Dakota, 81%. And you've got, you know, in this blue section here in the Maine, you've got quite a few community banks there. So they're not too bad. But then when you get to California, Florida, and Nevada, you know, then if you remember, they had the biggest foreclosure crisis. They had all these subprime blow-ups and whole communities were just wiped out because you know, they made all these bad loans and there was all this boom in housing that went bust. And these are the ones with the big banks and very little community banks. And New York State too, actually. The state is very different than the city, so you can't go by New York City. But the state had a lot of foreclosures as well. And so generally speaking, if you see a state with a lot of community banks, you have a low number of foreclosures. And I've found a weaker but still significant correlation between unemployment and number of community banks. So in other words, more community banks in the state equals lower unemployment as well. It's not quite a strong correlation, but it's there. But what's happening to these small banks? Well, they're disappearing, and fast. So in 1985, there used to be almost 14,000. Now we're down to 2,600. That's assets under 100 million. And the rest of it has kind of stayed the same. But the one that's really grown the most are the big banks with assets over 10 billion. So they've gone from 36 to 107. And overall, the banks have gone down from 18,000 to 7,600. And you know, now, of course, the dates are a little different. So it may disagree with what I said before. But basically, it's the same trend. So you can see this line over here, it's just dropping. So the small banks that do all the lending to the small businesses and the individuals are disappearing. And the big banks are not picking up the slack. So this is a real problem that the state bank can solve because they partner with these kind of banks. Another thing, as I talked about before, is a big capital project can take 50%, the expense can be 50% in interest. Not in the principal on the project, just in the accumulated interest. Now, Marguerite Kennedy did a more thorough study of this, and she said that on the average, drinking water cost of interest on capital was 38%. The rent on public housing, the cost of interest on that is 77% because they're constantly refinancing and they're having to pay interest all the time. Garbage collection fees, that's a little better. Cost of interest is only 12%. But on average, it's about 40% interest on all of these things put together in her study. So we're paying a lot of interest, and a state bank could alleviate that by concentrating the money in the state and making loans to these community banks and investing in the local communities. And then when they make money, it either comes back to the government in taxes or it comes back to the government in a dividend from the state bank. Okay, so now one last set of reasons for a public bank. We've got new liquidity rules because of Dodd-Frank, which could cause bond interest rates to soar, because now state and municipal bonds are exempt or excluded from being high-quality liquid assets, which means the banks can't have them in their portfolio as Tier 1 assets, so that then when they have to have reserves, they can't use these kind of bonds, which means that the bond rates will have to be higher, the interest that the bonds pay has to be higher in order to attract other buyers, because they're now not considered as high quality, which means the states have to pay more money. So if the states could self-finance, you know, either by a bank, a state bank buying up bonds and issuing interest to itself, basically, or paying the state itself, and we'll see a little later how we can do that, you know, that would keep all the money in the state. So here's an example of California, where almost half of their debt is in, their obligation is in interest, and then the other half is in principal. Another advantage to the state bank is a minimal operating costs. Here I always like to point out Jamie Dimon's salary. He makes $20 million a year. And the president of the Bank of North Dakota, he makes, it's Eric Hardemeyer, he makes $300,000 a year. So there's a big difference between a civil servant and a private banker. Now, you know, the State Bank of North Dakota had a little bit of an embezzlement scandal in the 1970s. That was it. And they've been around since 1919. That was the only time they had any trouble. Jamie Dimon and his J.P. Morgan has so far racked up $30 billion in fines since 2011 through 2013, and counting. So, you know, they've had multiple fines in a pretty weak regulatory environment, and yet they continue on with these big salaries. So banks do face new regulatory and compliance issues with Dodd-Frank. The small banks have a problem meeting them because they're so complicated. But a state bank might be big enough that it has the wherewithal and the expertise to help them meet them. So they could actually help these community banks survive by, you know, being sort of a mini Fed and helping them comply. It's a better option for the poor and unbanked because, you know, we have these payday lenders, which are just usurious rates. They can be hundreds of a percent. Some states are illegal, but in many states they're not. So it's a better option for the, for them. They can team, you know, a public bank can team up with a micro lender like Grameen Bank, which is now in Queens, not just in Bangladesh or some third world country, but in, it's here in Queens as well. And if we ever had public banking in the postal banks, which we used to have, they could team up with them too. The counter-cyclical lending. Well, Bank of North Dakota, when they had a big flood in Grand Forks a few years ago, they were able to forego the mortgage payments. In other words, people didn't have to pay their mortgages for a few months until they could get back on their feet and fix up their houses. And you can be pretty certain that a commercial private bank would not make that kind of forgiveness. But the State Bank of North Dakota, which is the state and is operating in the state's interest, decided that this was a good thing to do, not to have people to pay mortgage while they're also repairing their homes. So they suspended those payments. And it seems to be less corrupt and more efficient and more profitable. The Wall Street Journal just ran an article. They compared the Bank of North Dakota to Goldman Sachs, and they said the Bank of North Dakota was making better return on their investments. They've actually had almost a 20% return on equity in 10 years, every year. So they're doing something right. So we should do this in every state. That's what us public banking advocates say. Now, how do you fund it? Well, there's a number of ways to fund it. You can have equity in non-voting shares. I won't go through all of these. But the last one is the one I'm going to talk about in a minute. That's the investments that the state already has. And as we'll see, this is where the government financial assets are. These are enormous amounts of money. And they're mostly invested in Wall Street and in the schemes that those banks are invested in. They're paying these huge fees, multi-million dollar fees, for managing the money. And we could put the a portion of that into a public bank. So that leads into the next section, which is ending government financial asset hoarding, or GFI as I call it. So this is potentially the largest source of money, and people don't even know about this for the most part. You can't even call this a movement. It's really, it started from some people who looked at the financial assets of their states in their communities, and they saw that there were these huge hoards of money, and I'll explain why that's not so obvious to the public in a minute. But the point is that there are these every department, every fire department, every police department, every city, every agency in the city has to produce a financial report. If you add them all up, it's about 200,000 of these. And these financial reports, these comprehensive annual financial reports, if you add them up, there's trillions of dollars, possibly tens of trillions. And according to the guy who did the most work on this, who's Walter Burian, who he's done more than anybody by far. He says it's over $100 trillion in assets. Now, I can't add it up, so I can't verify that, but that's what he's saying. I have added up some of the CAFRs in New York State, and as we'll see, you can easily get up to a trillion without even breaking a sweat. All right. Now, what does a CAFR include? And this is a quote out of one of the first people who started it, who had a site called CAFRman.com. And he said, the CAFR is prepared under the accounting and reporting standards outlined by the Government Accounting Standards Board, GASB. It's an audited report, has four parts: government funds, proprietary funds, fiduciary funds, and component units. The budget you hear about involves primarily the government funds. So that's the first one. The other three major categories are not included in the budget. And this is in most cases where most of the surpluses are located. So you've got these proprietary funds, and you've got fiduciary, which can be a pension fund. You've got component units, which can be like the garage, city garage corporation. It can be at airports. It can be parks. So you've got these component units. That's not included in the budget either. So they have all of these assets, which are just not part of the budget. So now, the budget, here's how it works. The budget is, number one, the balance brought forward from the previous year's revenues not spent, the current projected revenues, and the current projected expenditures. So the budget is items number one and two minus item number three. So that's all you have to do. You have to add up one and two, and then you take away projected expenditures, and that's your budget. However, in the government's budget process, they forget about item number one. That's the carryover. So the money available and not spent in the previous year is not included in the budget. So instead, it's in this comprehensive annual financial report, so which is a much bigger pot of money. So the fourth axiom now, if a process can be made complex and obscure in order to benefit the elite, it will be, and we'll see who those elites are. All right, so what are our assets just in New York State? Just to give you something to work with here. So I looked up these, and I've done larger reports on this, and I talk about it in the book, of course, in Chapter 4. So we have, as of March 31st, 2014, $181 billion in the state fiduciary net position. That's basically the pension fund. And in the city pension fund, we have $192 billion as of June last year. Now, you'll notice that's almost a year old. Both of these are about a year old. So assuming that we had a pretty good year, which we did, and the kinds of things they invested, you can round that up to about $200 billion each, I think. So right away, you've got $400 billion. And remember, there's thousands of these funds. Now, these are two of the biggest, but still, there's thousands of others. So if you add them all up, we're easily talking trillions of dollars just in New York State. So now the question is, or one of the questions, is what if you took 10%? And remember, all of these are liquid assets. None of this is fixed capital. It's not roads and bridges or buildings or anything like that. It's all liquid investments. So what if you took 10% of that, in other words, $40 billion, and you put it into a public bank for the state, then you have a $40 billion bank, right? So that's one way we can get our bank without having to float a bond issue the way the Bank of North Dakota did, or without having to raise taxes or do something or take away money elsewhere. Yeah. So what you should remember that when people talk about the risk and the underfunding of a pension, it's not really underfunded, it's underperforming. And I'll show you how that works a little bit more. All right, now this will tell you right here. So in almost every case, governments have more than enough in their major investments like pension fund to cover expenses for years, even decades, even with a 0% return on investment. They often have enough in rainy day funds to cover their entire deficit. For example, the Public Banking Institute founder, Ellen Brown, I talked about, she found $71 billion in a treasurer's rainy day fund in California, which was enough to cover that state's $26.3 billion deficit, and twice over. So now, you know, you have to ask yourself, well, this is an interesting deal that they've made with us. They take out a big pot of money, they invested for us, often without telling the taxpayer what it's invested in, or putting it up for approval. And then they say, well, you know, we're not going to pay our expenses through taxes or through borrowing. We're going to pay them from the returns on our investments. So it's an interesting deal, because now you've got a fund which basically has to keep itself 95% invested, or maybe 94%, 96%. So they make, 4 to 6% return, and they use that 4 to 6% return to pay the pensioners. So instead of paying the pensioners directly, they have to keep this enormous pot of money, which has to keep growing, and they pay off a little bit of it each year, plus, of course, the employee and employer contributions for the year, which go into the fund as well. So here's going back to Ralph's question, well, are we invested in a dangerous place right now? Well, New York State lost $42 billion from 2008 to 2009 in its pension fund while they were complaining publicly about a $9 billion budget cap. So which is a more serious amount, the $42 billion or the $9 billion? Well, clearly, at that time, the fund was about $152 billion. To lose $42 billion from that is pretty darn serious. So they complained about a $9 billion budget cap, but look what they lost in the pension. So if we had some of that money in a public bank instead, it could be countercyclical. That public bank could kick in when there's not enough private investment. It could keep the state stimulated. It could, you know, sop up the excess employment, create jobs, create infrastructure when interest rates are so low, which they usually are during a recession. And, you know, we would have all of these benefits. So another problem with these investments that they currently have is the returns that they project are based on currently underperforming assets like bonds. And Reuters did a piece about this, which I write about in the book as well. And they say that, you know, well, the bond environment right now is paying next to nothing in interest, but it's going to go up. So you can't project out that it's always going to pay next to nothing in interest. So when the governor of the state, you know, or the comptroller says, well, we have to put more into the pension fund because they're underperforming, well, what are they basing that on? You know, maybe they're basing that on the bond returns because they have a lot of bonds. But if they're doing it from current returns, that's not, you know, historically, that's not realistic. So this is one problem. Another problem is those employee and employer contributions are not counted as fund income when they decide if the fund has a shortfall. So, you know, they've been projecting that the funds should return 8%. Well, first of all, that's unrealistic. But anyway, that's what they've been saying. The funds are going to give you 8% a year forever in perpetuity. That was the promise made to all the states. Well, we saw in the 2000s that was not true twice. It was 50% market crash two times. But they don't count the employer-employee contributions. If they did, the return on investment, the necessary return on investment could be cut in half because those contributions are typically about 4% of the fund. But they don't count that. And then the other thing is the private fund managers, and you can read Matt Taibbi's pieces on this, the private fund managers are the ones who measure and determine how to present the return on investment, not the overseeing comptrollers or treasurers or the committees that they form to decide on investments. And this has been shown to distort the returns and make them look like they're more positive than they really are. Because, you know, if you're a fund manager, you can choose your time period, when to start, when to stop, and you can make your fund look better than it really turns out to be. And then the biggest thing is that their non-current liabilities are measured years out, but the current assets are reported against them. So according to Walter Burian, quote, the new GAAP accounting implemented over the last 8 years, established by the GASB, requires local government accounting to project all liability as if it is due today. So, and they've been standardizing this. I called one of the Moody's vice presidents in terms of public relations, and he explained to me that they're trying to standardize all their, their ratings for all the states and all the cities. So they used to have, you know, some were projected out 8 years and some were 10 and 12. and some were 25. Now they made everything 20, which is on the high end. So they're projecting 20 years out for everything now, which means that this distortion is carried out for more states and cities than it used to be, and it makes things look worse. I wrote another article, which is in the book too, called Detroit is Not Broke. So it's a subset of America is Not Broke. And I showed all of these gimmicks and you know, things that they were doing. And I showed that actually Detroit had enough money. They could have kept going. They didn't have to declare bankruptcy. They could have gone for 15 years on what they had in their funds. And they just, the way that they chose to count the returns and projected returns and what they chose to say was going to be liable, it just distorted everything. But you have to read the book to get all that. It's complicated. That's why I left it for last. It's the most complicated thing. So, clearly, the CAFRs need an independent audit, and not by the officials whose next job is going to be on Wall Street. Remember, this is kind of a revolving door. You know, the treasurers and comptrollers, the next job's on Wall Street, then they come back to government and so forth. So they're not going to offend the people that they're going to work for very much. That would take a rare breed of person. Now, Scott Stringer, our new comptroller, he has come out against the high fees that the Wall Street banks are charging, but that's just the fees. That's only a superficial problem. But the problem is how they invest and whether they should be investing at all. And I've been after him to support a public bank, and he kind of gave a lukewarm support. He said it's an interesting idea, it's worth looking into. Well, we have to put the pressure on him, so he really looks into it. So that's what we're trying to do at the Public Banking Institute. Now, you can actually go to any of these CAFRs. They're all online, and they go back years. They all go back at least 10 years. It's closer to 15 now. And the review process is explained on this website up here is kafferman.com, which is in the book too. And I won't read it out, but this is how you do it. And when this was first developed, there weren't that many personal computers, so he actually said you didn't need a computer. You could do it with a pencil and a calculator. And there is actually a spreadsheet at kafferman.com, an Excel spreadsheet, and you can download that and just plug the numbers in for any CAFR you choose, because these are all standardized processes. So when you see a CAFR, it may be 300 pages long, but you only have to worry about 10% of that. So you learn where to look in there. You learn to look where the assets are. You don't really care about revenues and expenditures, because those are whatever they are. But it's the assets that we're talking about and where they are and what they're invested in. That's the important thing. So now you've got four choices. We've got sovereign money, land value taxation, public banking, or ending government financial asset hoarding. And whichever one you choose, there's a lot of groups and individuals to help and guide you. There's a school. There's lots of, it's Common Ground. There's Public Banking Institute. I list a whole bunch of them in the book. But just remember, America is not broke.
You just said that people like the controllers wouldn't want to offend the people they're going to be working for.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's one good reason that we should prefer politicians, as bad as that word sounds, to private bankers.
Yeah.
Because they would be working for us. Not only would they have fiduciary responsibility to the citizens, instead of just the shareholders,
right,
but they would also need, even more importantly, our votes.
Hopefully.
To keep their job.
Well, we do elect our comptroller and the treasurer,
yeah,
too. But
and the congressmen and senators and presidents, whoever is in charge. Plus, last but not least also, they're already in charge. In other words, whatever rules that the private bank is working under, they only have the right to create the money, etc., because it's given to them by the people,
right,
through the elected representatives. So it still comes down to the people we elect being in charge one way or the other, but this way they're more directly accountable as opposed to a greater interest in getting campaign contributions.
Yeah, I agree with you. And I think, as far as a campaign contribution, another thing, if we had sovereign money, we could pay for it with that. You wouldn't need corporate donations. You wouldn't need the Koch brothers. The government would basically create its own money to finance its own campaigns. And then I think we would have a totally different class of politicians.
The governor pardons you from your death sentence.
Yeah.
That's a fiat also. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because it's not all...
I wish they'd pardon all of us from the monetary sentence. Okay, so any other questions? In the back, way in the back.
How is the 18% land tax calculated?
Well, I have to give deference to my colleague, Lindy Davies, who's who actually found Common Ground in New York City, along with Rita Rowan. He did a report, and he calculated it out and figured out that if you raise the tax to that amount, you can get rid of all the other taxes. Now, the report is a few years old, and so I don't want to say that it's still 18%. It might be 20, it might be 16, or something else even. But it's close to that. And then again, you know, if you make new assessments, then it can go down because we're under-assessing the land. Although, I have to say, in Mayor Bloomberg's favor, he did spur a reassessment and try to get these assessments more up to date. So he was actually doing something good in that respect. So they're a little closer to reality at this point.
So yeah. Is the assessment based on the expenses?
Well, it's based on the $80 billion budget. Actually, it wasn't $80 billion when this report was written, but probably, let's say, $70 billion or $65 billion. So whatever the total expenses are for the city, if you divide that by the amount that you need from the property tax, this is the percentage of property tax you would need to have in order to meet those expenses. So they weren't changing the expenditures at all, it was just changing where the revenues come from. Anybody else?
In order to get from where we are now to where you think we should be, is it necessary to do this, what sounds like a very draconian thing? Wipe out all the other taxes and put this one in. It sounds like everybody out, because everybody's trying to figure out how
probably have to phase it in.
You do phase it in, how would you, is there a plan for that, or would that have to be...
Well, I'll give you an example. In Altoona, we have another colleague, Josh Vincent, from the Center for Study of Economics, and he works a lot in Pennsylvania. So in Altoona, they did that. They phased out the two-tier system and basically made a tax only on land. Now, they didn't get rid of the other taxes. That's something else. But as far as the property tax goes, they switched over to a land-only tax, and it took 10 years just to do that. So they phased it in over 10 years. Now, Harrisburg is another city where they went, they used to have a 2-to-1 tax. In other words, they charged twice as much for the land. The portion on the land was twice as much as the building portion, but they made it 6-to-1. So we listened to a speech from the mayor of Harrisburg for 25 years. He was a mayor. And he said it was the land value tax, the 6-to-1 ratio, that turned the city around. And it used to be the second worst city in the country. It was only second to East St. Louis. And when he took over in 1970-something, early 70s. And then it became one of the best. And I was there. I was at the Georgist convention. Rita and I were both there. And it was a nice, clean city to have a new island park. And it was, the streets were clean and the buildings were new. And, you know, it was just nice.
It sounds like a success story.
Yeah.
Are these success stories published? And if they are, how can every jurisdiction in the country use and say, hey, give me some of that?
Well, this is a good question. this is what we have to do as Georgists, or as people who want this to happen. There's a lot of vested interests who don't want it to happen. It does work if you implement it correctly and you consistently fight off the developers who want to keep a bigger share for themselves and the banks, which are two big lobbies. This is what we can have. So we have to make a people's organization that's equally powerful somehow. My little organization, Common Ground, not mine, but Common Ground was established in 1984. It's a national organization. There's 7 chapters. I'm the president of the New York Metro chapter. And we have 18 members at the moment, which is the largest chapter. But in any case, you need 18,000, I think, and maybe a petition with 100,000 signatures or something. You really, to counter that kind of special interest, you need a lot of people. And that is it for me. Thank you.